हेलो हेलो वेलकम ऑल। आई एम ए के चौहान एंड आई विल बी टेकिंग दिस कोर्स, द लास्ट पार्ट ऑफ द कोर्स व्हिच इज एडवांस मटेरियल केमिस्ट्री एंड मोस्टली डिवाइस मटेरियल्स। सो टुडे इन द फर्स्ट लेक्चर वी विल सी सम फंडामेंटल्स ऑफ सेमीकंडक्टर फिजिक्स। Because if you see devices, most of the devices they use semiconductors, or you can say more than 95% of the devices available use semiconductors in one form or another form. So semiconductors are very important, and therefore studying, or you can say understanding, the fundamentals of semiconductor physics are very or you can say equally important. One should have a fairly good idea about the semiconductors, what are they and how they work. So we will move slowly in this. Why slide is not moving? Yeah, so the first question is, what are semiconductors? If you see, semiconductors are materials. See, if you say all the materials, you can group the materials in three broad classes. They are conductors, insulators, and semiconductors. So conductors are the materials which has a very high conductivity. Insulators are those materials which does not conduct at all. And so there is in between these two class of materials the semiconductor lies. The you can say the conductivity of these materials are between this. So the semiconductor are substances with a conductivity between the which lies between the insulators and the good conductors. So if you say typical conductivity, electrical conductivity range of the materials, like if you see in this side, they are highly conducting materials. They are silver, copper, aluminum, platinum, bismuth, mostly metallic materials. And on the other side, you have a very, you can say, very less conductivity, or you can say insulating materials. There are fused quartz, sulfur, diamond, nickel oxide, glasses. The range you can see, it is the resistivity in ohm centimeter from 10 to the power 18 to somewhere around 10 to the power 7. It falls under the insulator range. Here it's in the conducting. This is somewhere. So in between these two class of materials, we have a you can say the materials which is are called semiconductors. So typically the conductivity, or you can say resistivity, is 10 to the power minus 4 to 10 to the power 6 range is the semiconductor materials. Now semiconductor materials are actually, you can say the materials, as I already said, these are electrical conductivity, which is important, you can say, in between conductors and insulators. So first thing is that what is actually electrical conductivity? So the electrical conductivity is a, you can say, result of movement of electrically charged particles. So electrically charged particles, if they are moving, they lead to the conductivity of electrical conductivity in any substance. So now usually when we say charged particles, mostly the charged particles means free electrons. So if there are free electrons, and if the free electrons can move, they cause the conductivity. Now these free electrons, when there are free electrons in a substance, they moves under the influence of an electric field. You apply a voltage. Because of that voltage, a field is generated, and you can say charged particle experiences a force and because of that force, it actually moves. So these very simple things which we have studied long back. So now we see materials. Huh? If I say the pure atoms, any pure material for the say sodium or any material, can a pure atom behave as a conductor, or we can say a good conductor? So if I take a pure atom, it will not be conducting any electricity because it does not have any free electrons. So if suppose somehow we remove these electrons from some of the electrons from a atom, or you can say from outermost of the orbit of the atom, by ionizing them, then there will be free electrons. So those free electrons then can participate in the conduction, and then they can there will be conductivity in the material. So yes, if we can pure atom cannot be a conductor, but if we can remove electrons from those materials, then it can behave like a conductor. So now we see for a current to pass the material to have conductivity, there are two parameters which you can say. Number one is availability of electrons, or I would say free electrons, and then there is capability of the movement. If the electrons are free but they are not moving, then also it is of no use, then there is no conductivity. So this is the one thing. So if you have free electron, so if you have electrons somewhere, they are actually not associated to the, you can say, atom, whether it can attain all energies, no, it cannot attain all energies. It can attain only those energies which are actually quantum mechanically allowed. But now when we are talking about the free electron is a, you can say, plane wave, and it can have almost all energies possible, because even small amount of energy, if you try to increase, that is also allowed for the free electron. But when it is in a certain, you can say, bound state, or in a some periodic potential, or in some kind of, you can say, potential well, in that case, electron cannot have all possible energies. It can have certain amount of energy. We will see a little later when we go to band structure that electrons cannot have all possible energies, but certainly a free electron can have all possible energies if it is outside. So now, as I said, what happens when it is subjected to a periodic potential? If an electron is inserted inside a free potential, then it does not behave like a free electron. It experiences a periodic force, and when you solve the quantum mechanical, you solve this system quantum mechanically, you find that there is only certain energies are allowed, not all energies. So then it is not it will not be a free electron, one can say. Now if we go, this was as far as the conductivity is concerned, or the electrons are the root cause of the conductivity, and then there should be free electrons as far as the possible, and if they are in certain conditions when the free electrons are not available, or the electron, if it is in a periodic potential, it doesn't behave like a free electron. So this was the, the reason of why some certain material behave like a insulator, certain material behave like a conductor, certain material behave like a semiconductor. So first, now let us see what are all semiconductor materials here. So if you see this is table, in this table this group, this is 4A group, which contains silicon, germanium, tin, and lead. So these materials are actually semiconductors. As we saw in the table, the conductivity table in the first slide, these are the conductivity of these materials falls between the conductor and the insulators. Then two materials, silicon and germanium. Out of them, silicon is very important. Why it is so important? Number one, the device gate silicon, it costs much less than other semiconductors because it has a lot of silica is available in the earth crust. So about 25% of the earth, it contains silica. So from silica, you can take silicon out. So then it becomes cheaper. So that is the reason why you have more, you can say, silicon materials. Then, so silicon is one of the most studied element in the periodic table. And the silicon technology is by far the most advanced and you can say, researched semiconductor technology. Can you move this up? That's good. So now it is not moving. So now these were the silicon and germanium. These two are elemental semiconductor, means they are in pure form or you can say in element form also, they behave like semiconductors. Now there is also, you can see in this group, there are some other yellow elements. They are aluminium, phosphate. So aluminum itself is a very good conductor, but when you make an, you can say, alloy of aluminium or you can compound between aluminium and phosphorus, so aluminium phosphate, or you can say gallium arsenide, indium antimonide, and similarly like zinc selenide, cadmium telluride. So these are also, they are also behave like semiconductors. So those semiconductors are called as the compound semiconductor. So if you say the a number of compound semiconductors, they are usually 3-5 element, which means the element which are a combination of one element from third group, another element from fifth group, the elements from second group to sixth group, and the element from fourth group to sixth group, they combine and they form a compound, you can say, element that also behaves like a semiconductor. So why actually? Because if you see in silicon, there are four electrons in outside orbit, and then when it form a covalent bond with other silicon, there are no free electrons available there. So in addition to these binary compound, you see some ternary compound also, where actually you have aluminium like gallium and arsenide. So some you can see a small subscript of X. So aluminium X, gallium 1 minus X. So if you see like aluminium or gallium, these are from the same group. They combine with the arsenic, which is here. So suppose I have a gallium arsenide, but certain amount of gallium I replace with aluminium. So in that case, my composition will become gallium 1 minus X, aluminium and arsenic. So these compound also are, you can say, semiconductor. And when you use three compounds, then these are called ternary compounds. And when you use four compounds, they are quaternary compounds. So like aluminium, gallium, arsenic and antimony. So this way, they are, you can say, by combining, usually by these, you can say, elements which are shown yellow, they show by combination of these, they can, you can make some semiconductors. But of course, it should be the valency, you can say, has to be considered carefully when you try to combine and make compound semiconductors. So many of these compound semiconductors have you can say electrical and optical properties that are different from those of the silicon. Why, we will come little later sometime, like direct and indirect when we are doing this. So now the first thing we saw what are semiconductors. So semiconductors are those materials which are having conductivity between insulator and conductors. And then we saw different element semiconductors also, binary compounds, and some ternary compound also we can make. Now see this, as we say in the initial slides, that atoms usually cannot conduct. So these have to form a compounds, and these compounds, as I say, semiconductor compounds are in form of the crystals. So most of the, you can say, semiconductor materials which are used in the industry or anywhere in the anywhere, they are generally single crystals. Why single crystals? Because in single crystals, the atoms are arranged in a three-dimensional periodic fashion. This is called as a lattice. Why it is so important? This periodic arrangement which I am talking is called a lattice. Actually, lattice means you can say points only. And if you put atom on that, that atom forms basis, and then it becomes a crystallization. So atoms are fixed on the lattice. Now the thermal vibrations associated with the atoms are, now the atoms are fixed at the you can say it at certain point. Now at absolutely zero Kelvin, all the atoms will be fixed there. But as soon as you start raising the temperature, the atom gains certain amount of thermal energy and they start to vibrate. So they start to vibrate about that particular fixed position wherever they have fixed. So as I also said, that lattice points are placed when the whole structure repeats by translation. The lattice is actually, you can say, you can say arrangement of points, and when you apply a certain translation on those points, you will get another similar point. So so this is called as the translational periodicity. So suppose you have a translation vector T, and then you have A, B, C parameters, and then U1, U2, and U3 are integers. So if you apply on any particular point in a lattice this T, then wherever you will reach will get the almost not almost exactly similar surrounding. So that is, if you can say, is a perfect lattice. So these crystal lattices, these are can be classified by their translational and rotational symmetries. What are translational symmetries? As I told just now, that if you apply a translation, you move by you can say certain T with U1 A1, U2 A2 plus U2 U3 A3, where you will reach at a you can say point which is identical to the initial point. So you can similarly you can apply rotational symmetry also. Like suppose you have a material and you rotate it, you have a you can say lattice and rotate it by 90 degrees, you will see exactly identical surrounding. So you will not be able to differentiate that whether it is original one or you have changed anything. So that is called a rotational symmetry. So in three dimensional you can say structures, if you apply all possible translational and rotational symmetries, then there are only 14 distinct lattice types are possible, and those lattice types are called as the Prove lattices. So these are those 14 different kind of Prove lattices. So it is cubic, and cubic can have three. Then you have tetragonal. Then you have in cubic like you have the parameters A, B, C. They are same, and the angle is also 90 degrees. In tetragonal, you actually slightly elongate this cubic structure in one direction, then it becomes tetragonal. Then similarly, orthorhombic system, you have you extend the third axis also. So A, B, and C are not actually equal, but angle is still 90. Rhombohedral means the cube. You just take these two points and stretch it slightly, one this side, another this side, and what you get is the rhombohedral system. Then monoclinic, in which A, B, C are not equal and angles are also not equal. And similarly, in triclinic also, A, B, C are not equal, angles are not equal. In this, two angles are equal, one is different. So for a given crystal, there is a unit cell which is representative of all the entire lattice. By repeating a unit cell throughout the crystal, one can generate the entire lattice. Cubic structures are important structures in semiconductor materials. So like this crystal structures, you must have studied in the initial lectures also. But why we have repeating? Because in semiconductors, these cubic structures are very important. And most of the materials, you can say, crystallize in these structures. So now let us see different kind of cubic structures. So cubic means the edges, this edge, and this edge, they are equal, and the angle between any of the two edges is 90 degree. So there are three type of cubic lattices are possible, Bravais lattice. One is the simple cubic. What is that? In the simple cubic, you have 8 atoms on the corners of the unit cell. In BCC, you have 8, you can say, atoms at the corners of each cell. At the same time, you have one atom at the body center also. In face-centered cubic, there are 8 atoms at 8 corners, and then one at each faces of the cube. So total there will be 6 faces. So if you can say there are 6 faces, so 6 atoms there and 8 atoms there. Now if you see sharing of these atoms by this particular unit cell, so if this each corner is shared by 8 similar, you can say, cells. So 1/8 part of the this atom is in this cell, and you can say remaining 7/8 part are in the other adjacent unit cells. So that way, if you see the single, you can say, simple cubic is having one, you can say, total atom, 1/8 multiplied by 8. And the BCC will have one this atom, which is at the body center, is totally inside this, and then there are 8, so there will be 2. And FCC, there will be 6 faces, half of the every face has an atom which is shared by 2 cells, so half will be in this, half will be in the other, so 3 those plus 1 of these, so there will be 4 atoms shared. So in simple cubic structure, and there is 6 equidistant atoms, one this side, and another this side, so in body centered cubic crystal, when this I have already explained, so this is something. Now when we see this FCC structure, so this FCC structure is like this. Why this FCC structure is important? Because most of the metals are crystallized in this structure. BCC also, few metals crystallize. Simple cubic, there are very few, or very, you can say, less atoms. But mostly in the FCC structures. And our semiconductor materials also, they are actually a class of this FCC only. So we will see how it moves. So let us see how this FCC is first generated. So suppose you have some balls, okay. If you want to can say closely pack the balls, how you will be actually packing them? So you will have a layer of balls, and then balls means you can say atoms, I will say. So if you will put all the balls in the floor in a closely packed fashion this way, so now when you want to put another layer over this, where you will put the atom? You will put atom where actually in between these two, you can say atom. So the second layer you can put between, here, like at this place there is space, this place there is space, this place. So you can put atoms there only or balls here only. So this way, so the second layer is put like this, and the third layer is also. Then again, if you try to put a third layer, then also you will have similar choices. So like in this case, you can put here, 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 or there is an alternative way also. If you have put it here, you can put at this place also, this place also, this place also. So this structure, when you put the other way, the structure is when this layer is A, suppose this layer is B, and suppose this layer is C. So this forms a face-centered cubic structure. And if you try to put the same structure like just above this atom, like here, if you try to put this, in that case, it will be a AB, AB, AB kind of structure, and that will be an hexagonal closed pack structure. So this structure is FCC, you can say closed pack structure. Now, so this is the structure. Now, here it looks like hexagons, but see, they are different hexagons, but how it is actually FCC. So if you see here, just for comparison, I have shown it. So this is a FCC structure where there are atoms at, you can say, 8 corners, and then there are atoms at 6 faces, here also, here also. You see, so I have put 2 unit cells, 2 FCC cells, one above the other, and then you try to see this plane. So this plane is actually the plane which I have drawn here. I have tried to draw here. So if you see, now they are exactly, you can correlate them. So this is actually FCC structure where these planes, when you close pack one plane above the A, B, and C form, then in the other direction, you can get a clear FCC. So now you see 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 and the center. So this is the same like structure which I was showing earlier. And then above that, you have either put it here or here or here, and similarly in the back side also. So this is an FCC structure. Now why we actually are studying FCC structure? Because number one, most of the metals, they crystallize on the FCC structure. But more important than that is the semiconductors are crystallizing a structure which is actually very, you can say, it is derived from the FCC structure only. So this is a, you can say, diamond structure. Why we are saying it's a diamond structure? Because diamond crystallize in this structure. Diamond is, you can say, form of carbon only, and the arrangement of atom are in this format. So now this looks very, you can say, complicated. When you see in the beginning, it is like, so you can say, some atom, some more, very complicated structure. But if you try to see it more closely, you can see, you can distinguish in this way. There's 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8 atoms, so in the cube. And they are in the faces also, you can see 1, 2, 3, that side also, here also, here also. So there are atoms which are at the center of faces also. So it's a kind of FCC structure only, but there are some extra atoms. So where are those extra atoms? One is this extra atom, another is this extra atom, one is this here, and similarly one is here. So so this actually is This structure, diamond structure, is a structure. Now, if I say that you have two FCC structures and one FCC structure, which is you put under, you can say put inside another FCC structure by, you can say moving the coordinate by exactly 1/4, 1/4, and 1/4. So what you will get is actually two interpenetrating FCC structures. But this is a diamond structure. And why diamond structure is important? Because silicon crystallize in diamond structure. So that is why we are actually studying. So if now if you try to visualize in the same way, like I tried to explain in the earlier slide. So you have like three atoms, three spheres. Put one means close to each other, and then there is a position that you will put another fourth atom here. So this is actually, you can say, this is called as tetrahedral void. So now you try to do somehow, try to put another atom, try to you can say force another atom it will in between these four atoms. Then you will be able to say that this is actually the this structure, diamond structure. This is not a diamond structure. This is a tetrahedral void. You have three spheres and you have put another sphere above that. But suppose you take another, you can say, sphere and try to force that atom or sphere in between these four atoms. So, and then if you try to make them, you can say, equidistant by putting some constraints, in that case, that will be actually a kind of diamond structure. So this same structure is here. You have, will see here. I will show in the next slide how the tetrahedron is made. So in a diamond structure, then you have actually atoms. If you try to see from the bottom, upside, so you have atoms at 0, 0, 0, 0 positions as it was in cubic, then half positions as it was in FCC, then of course at 0 because it's a FCC similar structure, and at the in the upper side also at the same distance, and then you have atoms at 1/4 and 1/4 here, and then at 3/4, 3/4 here, when 3/4 means 3/4 of A in you are moving, you can say, in upside. Now, so if you say diamond lattice, as I explained, diamond lattice consists of two interpenetrating FCC lattices, basis of, you can say, or we can say one FCC structure, which is having basis of two atoms. One is at 0, 0, 0. And another is a 1/4, 1/4, 1/4, 1/4. So imagine you have a only FCC structure, and then you have each, you can say, lattice point is having two atoms. One is a other one is actually, you can say, displaced by 1/4, 1/4, 1/4 displaced. It is not a Bravais lattice. FCC is a Bravais lattice, but diamond structure is not a Bravais lattice, because if you see any electron, any atom, which is, you can say, like if you move from this side to this side, you will see one atom here. But if you try to move in the opposite side on the same distance, then you will not be see another atom. So this point and these points are actually not equivalent. So in that case, so you can we cannot say it is a Bravais lattice, but how if you can say consider this point and this point, both you can say this point and or you can say this point and this point both as a one lattice point, or you can say this atom and this atom attached at one lattice point, then you can call it as a Bravais lattice. It's a FCC Bravais lattice. So carbon, silicon, germanium, tin, these crystallize in the diamond structure. So for diamond as such, diamond is carbon when it crystallizes in this structure. So it has a lattice constant 3.5 7 angstrom, and for silicon the latest constant is 5.43 angstrom. So like what I was saying here, this slide I have copied from some internet, it is not made by me. So you see this, if you can see the blue are you can say atoms, but there is another atom here somewhere in green, and then a tetrahedra has been made. So there is a you can say 1, 2, 3 atoms, 1, 2, 3 atoms, 4 atoms, and in between there is another atom. So exactly like I was explaining, you have 3 atoms and then you have forced the fourth atom in between them. This distance, ideally the distance, the bond length which we are saying is suppose you try to just to visualize, to try to reduce this length to as small as possible. Now a similar structure like a diamond structure, silicon crystallized in diamond structure, germanium also crystallized in diamond structure, but there is another structure which is a zinc blend structure. So it is a similar structure like a diamond structure, but what we have is the atom which is at the, you can say, zero position, and the atom which is at 1/4, 1/4, 1/4 position, they are different. They are of two, you can say, different elements. So then the similar structure, which was actually we are calling diamond structure, has become a zinc blend structure. Why we call it zinc blend? Because originally, it was named after the compound zinc sulfide, which crystallized in this structure. So this is similar to the diamond structure. And in this, as I already said, there are two atoms. And now this is why we are actually again studying this: gallium arsenide, gallium antimonide, indium arsenide, silver iodide, etc. All these crystallize in this structure. So now see, almost whatever we have seen, almost all classes of semiconductor materials crystallize either in the diamond structure or in the zinc blend structure. So these structures are very important. So especially for semiconductor physics. So if we try to compare these two structures, so these two are technologically important structures because many common semiconductors have diamond structure or zinc blend crystal structures, which I already explained. And these shares same geometry as we have already seen. In both these structures, the atom are all tetrahedrally coordinated. That is, atom has four nearest neighbors. In both these structures, the basis contains two atoms. Basis means you can say on every lattice point, whatever you put and you repeat it every lattice point, you get the crystal structure. So in both the structures, the permittive lattice is actually a face center cubic, which we have already seen. So in both the diamond and zinc blend structure, there are two atoms per FCC lattice point. However, in diamond, these two atoms are same, and in zinc blend structure, these two atoms are different. So one thing is this, we have seen the atomic structure of the, you can say, crystal structure of the, not atomic structure, crystal structure of the semiconductors. Now, within a crystal lattice, it is possible to identify a set of equally spaced parallel planes, and these are called as the lattice plane. Why these lattice planes are important? Because the each you can say plane will have a different interplanar spacing. If you have certain plane and you just try to see a perpendicular plane, if it is not a cubic or it will have a different distance. So the crystal properties therefore will be different in both the direction because the distance, interplanar distance, is different. So therefore the electronic, you can say, properties of the material will also be direction dependent in certain cases, not in all, but in certain cases. So There, so there we have we need to you can say define if these planes also we should know in around which plane we are measuring. So there is a method to define the planes. This method is called as the Miller indices, and these indices are used by you can say on a crystalline structure. First, you find the intercept of planes on three Cartesian coordinates in terms of lattice constants. Then take the reciprocal of these numbers and reduce them to the smallest three integers having the same ratio, and then ultimately the end and close the result in the parenthesis. So this is the procedure. Suppose we have a you can say a plane, and this is x, y, and z axis, and it is a suppose a cubic crystal. So interplanar distance should be a. So this plane is cutting at x axis at 3a, at y axis as 2a, and at z axis at 1a. So now suppose we want to find out the plane, which plane it is. So first we will actually make you can say 1/3a, and then 1/2a, and then 1/a, and then multiplied by a. So this will be the reciprocal of one. The reciprocal will be 1/3, 1/2, and 1. And the then the you can say this ratio will be you can say multiplied by 6. So then it will be 2, 3, 6. So the plane will be in that case 2, 3, 6 plane. So this is the way to find out Miller-Indices. So we have seen the crystal structure of why we have seen, because that is important for our semiconductor materials, and then we have seen the planes also, how to define the planes, different planes. Now let us see when you make when you bring the atoms together, how they form the bonds. Actually they so these are so each atom in a diamond lattice, suppose we are talking about the diamond lattice only, is surrounded by four nearest neighbors, and as we have seen, they are tetrahedrally bonded, one atom, and then there are three atom, one top and then three bottom side. So if we see this atom, suppose it is a 1/4 1/4 1/4 silicon, then one atom will be here, one atom will be here, one atom will be here, one atom will be here. In two dimensional, we can just simply represent this like this, silicon, and here these are four electrons of silicon. So these four electrons, we have a nearest neighbor of silicon also. It is also having four electrons. So these two electrons will be shared by these, and then so this silicon will make an is complete will outer orbit with 8 electrons. So this bonding is you all of you know it is a covalent bonding. So each atom has 4 electrons in the outer orbit, and each atom share these valence electrons with 4 neighbors, and this sharing of electrons is known as covalent bonding. So gallium arsenide crystallized in zinc plant lattice, which is also a tetrahedral bond. The major bonding forces in gallium arsenide is also due to the covalent bond, which is a component of ionic bond. So so it is actually you can say if we say gallium arsenide, here we will have one here gallium, and at this place it will be arsenic. So now how the conduction takes place. So at low temperature, if I say at absolutely 0 Kelvin, all the atoms are actually you can say fixed at their positions, and they have zero thermal energy. So all the electrons are bound at the with their atoms. But as soon as the temperature start rising, the thermal energy of the lattice increases, and so electrons, you can say some electrons, they actually you can say the bond is broken. The electron they just come out of the bond, and then but they still they remain in the surrounding only. So if you have not applied any field, or So this after some time they will recombine. So if you see here, it is a phonon. Phonon is phonon means a heat, you can say equivalent to photon with a low energy in few MeV. So this of the thermal energy. So this is actually absorbed by this electron and get this. So at higher temperatures, these thermal vibrations, they make they break the covalent bonds and ionize one electron from the bond. And when the bond is broken, a free electron results, and which can participate in actual conduction. Maybe we can have a little break for 5 minutes before we continue. Which
sir, you can directly ask just the question. Thank you.
Yes, there is a question someone has asked that they sir, should it not be 8 atoms per unit cell? Yes, in the case of there will be total 8 atoms. So can we just okay, so now we have 5 minutes break and then we will continue. So shall we start now? Okay. So now, so far we have seen atoms, or you can say how they are bonded, but when they are actually in crystal, they are you can say so many atoms we are actually they are together. They are not individual atoms. So like we saw four atoms, but what about 10 to the power 23 or 10 to the power so many atoms, if you say them, if you put them together, then actually they behave differently. So how let us see this here. So like suppose you have an isolated atom. An isolated atom means suppose for example hydrogen atom. So if a hydrogen atom, it is having one proton and then an electron is revolving around it. So it has only, you can say, certain fixed amount of energy which is given by this Bohr's model. So it can have either minus 13.6 electron volt when it is in the n is equal to 1 state, means in the first you can say orbit, and then either it can have -3.4 electron volt if it is in the second orbit, and then in the same way. But it can have only fixed energies, it cannot have all energies. But what happens, so these energies are fixed, so it is, if it is 13.6, it will be exactly 13.6. So if you give that particular electron 13.6 electron volt, then it will you can say accept it, otherwise it will not accept. So it can have only certain fixed amount of energies, not more than that, not less than that. So now if you bring two atoms together, suppose you two hydrogen atoms, or for the sake, not only any two you can say atoms, if you want to bring them together, then when they are at a you can say very far distance, then there is no problem. But when you try to put them together, and then when atomic you can say orbitals, or you can say these orbitals start overlapping, then there are problems. So when they are at very far distance, means you have two atoms, one is here, another is at infinite distance, then they have exactly same you can say energy level, and it is called as you can say for two atoms it is doubly degenerate level. Degenerate level means that energy is exactly same though there are two atoms. So this is the case when you have two atoms at a very far distance. But problem starts when you start bringing them together, bringing them closer. So when they are brought closer, these two means the level which was actually same, when they start interacting, this level splits into two levels. After the interaction of these electrons, this the main reason behind this is the Pauli's exclusion principle, which states that no more than two electrons in a given system can reside in the same energy state at the same time. When they were at very far distance, they were not interacted, so they were two you can say separate atoms or separate individuals, you can say. But when they become when they come together, then it becomes a system, and in that system, when they are interacting in that system, then no two electron can have all four quantum numbers equal. So that is, so now, so therefore if they cannot have both all four quantum numbers equal, so the levels has to split, means something, some energy has to change so that both can you can say satisfactorily say, okay, we are not in the same energy level. So this was in the case of two atoms. Two atoms is very simple, but when we deal in the solid state, Then there are n numbers. N numbers means very large number. As I said, about 10 to the power 23, 10 to the power 24 atoms per centimeter cube. So it's a very huge number. So if you try to bring them all together in a, you can say, in a very close distance and interacting to each other, then it is the problem has to be the problem is complicated. So so the orbit of you can say all the outer you can say not all I can say but the they of at least nearest neighbors, they interact with each other. This interaction, including those force of attraction and repulsion with the neighbor, the nearest neighbor and the farthest near, so all the, you can say, with all the atoms they form a system which is actually having effect of all the atoms which are there in the you can say that system or in that lattice or in that crystal. So they will be interacting, and if there are n like in earlier when we said there were two atoms and then energy level was split in two, so when there are n atoms, then of course, and if all of them are interacting, then the same level which was initially split into two, now it will be split into n separate but closely spaced levels. They are separate. So it is like this. So suppose there were n atoms which were at very far distance, and then when you try to bring them together, in that case here they start interacting, and then this band started, you can say. So here at this point you can say there are n at this distance A, which is an interatom distance for any crystal. So in that case, that level has split it into so many levels, or you can say n levels. So when n is very large, the result is almost continuum, though they are actually separated, but they are very, very closely separated. So you can say any you can say continuous you can call it as a continuous. But now what is actually important in continuous, in one of my earlier slides I told you that atoms can have only those energies which are actually allowed. But when you are having a nearly continuous band of energy, that means electron can have all the energies possible. So if there is one electron which is there in this continuous band, then you can give even a small amount of energy, it will accept it. So because there is an energy level is available for that energy also. Suppose at present it is having E, and then you have very small delta E increase, so E plus delta E is also available in the same band. So then electron will accept that, so energy of the electron will increase. So this band of n level can extend over a few eV, this from here to here it can have a few eV, and of course to the interatomic distance can say interatomic distance of the crystal. So the electron now can no longer be treated as belonging to their parent atom, but the electrons now they will be treated that as they are actually belonging to the entire crystal. So like earlier when the electron was associated to one, you can say, silicon atom, now it is not associated to one silicon atom, but it is associated now to the entire silicon crystal. Now if you say now let us talk about the silicon. sorry. So now this was a like in this was a general statement about the splitting of energy level into you can say a band. Now let us consider the case of silicon. Now silicon is having you can say 14 electrons. 14 electrons means out of these 14 electrons, 10 electrons are there inside the inner orbits, and there are only you can say 4 electrons which are in the outer orbits. These 4 electrons are actually only active. So these 4 electrons takes part in the chemical, all the chemical reactions. So we consider these 4 electrons for all electronic structures and other things, because the inner one do not participate. So like these 14 electrons, if I say 1s2, 2s2, 2p6, 3s2, 3p2. So there are, you can say, 2 electrons in 3s state, and there are 2 electrons in 3p state. P means when L is equal to 1, and S means when L is equal to 0. So S has that you we know from the basic chemistry that S can have only 2 electrons, and P can accommodate up to 6 electrons. So actually P can accommodate 6 but have 2. S is totally occupied with the it can maximum have 2 electrons, and it is having 2 electrons. So now what happens when you bring see, when they were at a very far distance, in that case there are 3 state 3s and then 3p. So there are 2, they were in single atom, there were 2 electrons in p, and there were, you can say, 2 electrons in s. Now we have made n atoms. So now we are trying to make n atoms and in a crystal, and then let us see what happens. So now there will be actually 2n you can say electrons in 3s state and 2n electrons in the 3p states of n individual atoms. And how many states are there total? There are 6n states. So in S also there are actually 2n states, and all 2n states are occupied. However, in P there are actually you can say 6n states, but 2n states are occupied and 4n states are vacant, still vacant. Now what happens when we try to bring them together? So as you try to bring them together, these 3s and 3p bands, they grow, they merge into a single band containing an 8n state. So you bring them together, you will find that at this particular point, that is at this distance, then this band and this band, you see, this band is splitting, this band is also splitting. At this particular point, they merge together and form a single band. Now what will happen if you try to bring them further closer? So they are actually much more close than so after this they will again start separating. So at a temperature near absolutely zero, so first thing is that let us see from this point when you try to further actually bring them together, in that case they further split. So now what happens, since they were initially merged, so now there are 2 states, one state is here and another state is here. At this particular, this is suppose I start considering silicon atom which has crystallized in a diamond structure. So within you can say atomic you can say spacing of 5.43 angstrom or a value for silicon, lattice constant. So for this particular value between 2 silicon atoms, this is actually the structure of you can say bands. So if I extend it here, so this is one band and this is another band. If you calculate the gap between these two, it will be 1.12 electron volt. So now what will happen? So there are total, there were actually initially there were 8 N states. Now also here also there are 8 N states, but there are 4 N states here and then 4 N states here. So all the electrons which were there, some of the electrons are there in this state, some of the electrons are there in this state. So all the, I say 4 N electrons now will occupy these lower states. Because why they will occupy the lower energy states? Because in a, any system, the electron try to occupy the you can say lowest possible energy state. So now these lower you can say states will be completely filled, and these higher you can say states will be totally empty. So this lower you can say this band is called as the valence band, and this upper band is called as the conduction band. Why it is called valence band and why we will come later about this. So you see that way the band is formed. So now the bottom of this conduction band is called as is represented by EC, this particular value, and the top of the valence band is called as EV, this value. So gap between EV and EC is band gap, and this is called as the you can say for silicon it, the value is 1.12 electron volt. So physically, actually, if you see a crystal, the meaning of EG is that it is energy required to raise one electron from this particular position to this particular position. Now ideally at zero Kelvin, all the 4N electrons, all the electrons you can say which are they, which were there in the silicon, all of them will be in this state. So and now this state is actually totally filled. Now if you see, there is a gap between this. Now if it is filled up to this point, and now you try to give little energy to this electron which is there in the top of, even if at the top of the valence band, whether it can accept that energy? No, because just above this there is no you can say energy level available for that particular electron. Where is that energy level available for that particular electron? Is at this point. So it, this electron which is here at this EC value or EV value, sorry, at EV value, it can accept only energy when it can reach up to this point. So if you give such this much amount of energy, then it will happily accept and reach here in the conduction band. But the energy, any energy below 1.12 electron volt is not acceptable to this, because the energy level does not exist here. So you need at least this much energy to raise an electron from this place to this place. Now suppose an electron has reached to this place, and then it is good, it is at the bottom of the conduction band. Now this is the entire, you can say, empty band. Now it can accept any energy. You give any voltage, any voltage, any small voltage, even 0.01 volt. So the electron which is having any energy, now the its energy will be increased by E multiplied by that delta V or V. So that energy also exists here in the conduction band, because this is almost continuous. So once an electron has reached in the conduction band, so then it can accept any energy, and then so it can move. So that's why once an electron has reached in the conduction band, it can have a good conductivity. But at zero Kelvin, absolutely there is no electron in the conduction band. Now let us see another important thing, which is an energy momentum diagram. This part is clear to everybody, because this is important. How bands are formed. Now let us see the energy momentum diagram. This is also a very, you can say, important concept in semiconductor physics. Now, if we see classically, so what is energy? If an electron is moving with velocity v, how we can say the energy will be half mv square? So E is equal to half mv square, suppose we say. And what is momentum? Momentum is simply mass multiplied by volume. So if you try to make a relation between energy and momentum, then this E is equal to p square upon 2m0, or this is mass. So now why I am saying this, see, this looks very trivial, but actually when you are dealing in quantum mechanics, in place of energy, p is energy is also important, but p is also very important, because p can be directly related to the wave vector. Mostly in quantum mechanical systems or in semiconductor physics, when we are doing quantum mechanics mechanical treatment, then we are dealing with the wave vector, not directly with the p, because it is not classical, no longer classical. So to begin with, let us have only momentum only. So p square upon 2m. So this is very simple. It is, suppose I have an, you can say, I want to plot a graph where on x-axis I have momentum, on y-axis I have energy. E is p square upon 2m0. From my basic math, I know since it is p square, so there will be a parabola. It will be symmetric towards on this axis. So the parabolic, so this is actually, you can say, an ideal momentum energy curve should be followed. So I will repeat it once again. It is energy momentum diagram where on one axis you are plotting the momentum, on another axis you are plotting the energy. It is then this diagram is called as the energy momentum diagram, and it is a very, very important diagram in semiconductor physics or in quantum mechanics or quantum mechanical treatment of the semiconductor physics. So isme kya, what is there in that? It is so simple thing. It is everybody can plot that. Now problem starts. See, when we are treating this classically means electron can have any energy. So it is like a ball, it is moving, half mv square is okay, is energy. But when it is in a crystal, even if it is in a conduction band, then it is like a free electron. But when it is not like in conduction band, or if it is in a periodic potential, when an electron is in a periodic potential, in that case, this we can say very simple treatment is not actually valid. We need to modify it a little bit. So now this when we treat and when we you can say treat move an electron in a periodic potential, or we throw an electron in a periodic potential, in that case this simple equation is not possible. This equation is not applicable, because electron is no longer a free particle. It is actually moving inside a potential. So but we are very actually fond of this curve. So we want to stick to this curve. So we have to do certain modifications. So what we have done, actually we are very smartly, what we did, okay, this m0 was actually a mass of a free electron. Now okay, I will not consider it as a mass of free electron. I would say it is a mass of effective mass of electron. So if I give certain, you can say if an electron cannot move, if an electron cannot move, that means it has infinite mass. And if electron can move, then it is, you can say it is having same mass, which was rest mass of the electron. So then a concept of, you can say, effective mass came. And this effective mass is actually just to, you can say, make us happy. And so that we can always use such kind of, you can say, relation between energy and momentum. And so then energy we can define p square upon 2mn, where mn is the actually effective mass. So effective mass is, I say, when electron is free, in that case the effective mass of electron is the mass of a free electron. But when it is a periodic potential, in certain cases we will see that electron, even if you apply a you can say potential or a voltage or any field, it cannot move. In that case, why? So ideally it should move. That if I have an electron, I have applied a potential, it should move, but it is not moving. So rather than believing that my equation is not working, p square upon 2m, because my energy is very high, because I have already applied certain voltage, electron charge is E, so energy should be E into E. So momentum should be this much, but since it is not actually accordingly increasing the momentum, so what I say, okay, now I think mass of the electron has changed, mass of electron has increased. So that is actually the reason behind, you can say, placing a concept of the effective mass. So we can actually solve the equations easily by, you can say, using the same momentum equation. Now if you want to find out the you can say effective mass, then obviously very simply you have the energy EP curve, you double differentiate and take a reciprocal of that, it will give you an effective mass. Now narrower the parabola. So now if you see here, see the effective mass, if the electron is in conduction band, the effective mass is here 0.25 in this particular case. So effective mass is actually 0.25 of the rest, you can say, initial or say the free electron mass. And then in valence band, it is actually the mass is equal to the mass of free electron. So if we have a narrower parabola, that means it has a smaller effective mass. So the effective mass concept is very useful. As I already said, it is because it enables us to treat electrons and holes essentially as a classical charge particle, though they are not. But by making this assumption, we do it. Now let us see one more important thing. I said, like I mentioned in earlier slide also, when an electron moves in a periodic potential, what happens? So suppose you have a lattice, suppose of any material. So you have a lattice, there are atoms and there are electrons. So electrons have, you can say, all electrons are removed, they are in the material, they are moving here and there. And there are, you can say, atoms are, ions are fixed because they cannot move. So now you have a lattice of, you can say, some A, you can say, lattice spacing. So there are you can say, ions sitting there. Now you have an electron which is actually moving from this place to this place. So when it is here, see, it is seeing this electron also, this ion also, this ion also, this ion also, this ion also. So it is, when actually electron, it will be attracted by this, it will be attracted by this, it will be attracted by this, it will be attracted by this. So, but that attraction will depend on the distance also. So if I try to plot this, the same like movement in place of in terms of potential. So you have ions here, and then so potential which this electron is seeing, see how much potential. If it is, it comes near here, the potential is less, here it is potential less, here potential more. So it will see this kind of potential. And if you try to see the the square wave, square well kind of thing, you will see this well. So you that means this electron is actually moving under this potential well, this kind of potential well. So now the electron is actually in a lattice. Electron, if it electron is in a lattice, or if a electron is in a crystal, it is moving under a definite potential well, or potential step, or a, you can say, periodic potential. So if it is moving in this direction, so you can say this period will be according to this direction. If it is moving in this direction, then you will have a period in you can say this way. Suppose lattice spacing is a, in that case this periodic potential, it will be repeatable to by exactly the distance a. Now if you solve this, now this electron, it is actually not a classical particle, it is a quantum particle only, because it's moving, it is having certain amount of energy, and mass is also very low, so you cannot treat it as a absolutely a classical particle. So you have to treat it quantum mechanically. So this electron, if you try to solve this electron, I will not go into detail of that. So if you try to solve this you can say this Schrodinger equation for this particular system, an electron which is moving under this potential well, or you can say under this periodic potential, so this is actually the solution, and this solution is actually in the one side it comes about a sine function, so sine value, or you can say cos value. So that cannot have, you, we know that sine, the value of sine cannot be more than 1, it cannot be less than minus 1. So the value of sine actually you can say it varies between minus 1 and plus 1. Now we have a solution for the electron which says it should follow this path, is it not? But the mathematical equation which says that it is actually a sine curve, so the value of sine cannot be more than plus or minus 1. So it can be only, you can say, applicable up to this point only. So these things will not be valid. So the solution of the equation will exist only for this period, from this period to this period, from this period to this period, from this period to this period, and in this period there will not be any solution. So we can say that during this period, you can say, so during this period, from this point to this point, or this point to this, there is no solution exist. So now if we try to draw the EK diagram, or you can say EP diagram, EP diagram means, initially I said when I treated the particle totally as a you can say classical, normally I say P, but P is equal to P, you can convert into so you can say wave vector, it is h cross k. So it is interchangeably, we use either P or wave vector, but like for understanding you consider it is same, it is either it is P or it is K. So now if you see, ideally in last slide we saw a perfectly you can say parabolic figure here, but here now we don't see parabolic figure, because in certain you can say areas this equation is not satisfying. So now you will have gaps here. So for classical particle it was okay, fine, but when a particle is under a periodic potential, in that case the momentum and energy relation is not continuous. So when this relation is not continuous, so there is a break from this point to this point. So this much you can say for this particular value of momentum, this particular value of momentum, there is no continuity in the energy. So energy either exists here or exists here. So there is a gap between these two. This is actually what we called as the forbidden gap. So now this part is also, we can say, one up to this point, electron can have energy, but then it cannot have energy from this point, then it can have energies from this here to here, then it cannot have, there is a gap from here, then again there is a gap. So these are actually, so these gap arise because of the periodicity of the crystal, and these are very, very important, you can say, phenomena. The understanding is very important, because on the basis of this entire, you can say, semiconductor devices, they work. So you have a gap actually. Because why you have a gap? You have this gap has come because of the periodicity in the lattice. Fine. So now let us see. So now we have like this energy momentum diagram. See, this was an energy momentum diagram. This is also energy momentum diagram. Earlier also we see energy momentum diagram. So now let us forget for some time this gap. Now we see from this point it is here, and this also you add it here. So they are symmetric. So like at minus pi by a also, you can plot it like that. You can merge both of them together. This is the concept of Brillouin zone comes. We don't want to go because it's quite involved, you can say, topic. So let us first see. So let us see the energy momentum diagram for a few very, you can say, important semiconductors, that is silicon and gallium arsenide. This is also, you can say, a very important, and I want you to please pay attention on it. So if you see in silicon, if you see, the first thing is that these band diagrams are not as straightforward as I was trying to explain you in EK diagram. Okay, it was a simple parabolic curve, but this is not a simple parabolic curve. See, there are, in earlier slides also I said, there are different planes. In one side you will have, you can say, certain wave function. In wave function same, in certain, you can say, periodicity. In another direction you will have another periodicity. So if you try to explain the same Schrodinger equation, you will get a different solution. So you will have in one direction, suppose you are from this place to this point in one direction, if I try to put, ideally it will be symmetric. Suppose I put one in 100 direction in this way and 100 in this way, but for simplicity, or you make it more clear, I have plotted it in two different directions. So it is towards 100 and it is towards 111. It is actually very important. See, ideally it should be symmetric, but when it is not symmetric, because I have plotted it in two different directions. So you, for the, like, if you want to understand only one part, just you ignore this one. So now let us have from zero, this is EP, this is energy, this is your momentum. So here the maximum of the valence band is at this point, and now the minimum of the valence conduction band is at this point. So you see there is a gap. There is a gap means they are not aligned, they are not actually at the same momentum. So suppose you want to make it, you want to transfer an electron from this point to this point, it is not straightforward. You have to increase you have to give energy, you have to increase momentum also, and you have to increase energy also. So if you see the periodicity, as I already said, periodicity is different in both directions. So, if the you can say minimum of the conduction band, if it is at p is equal to zero means, suppose at this point, this means that the effective mass of electron in every direction of the crystal is same. It is similar. And it also indicates that electron motion is independent of the crystal direction. If it is at the p is equal to 0. But like in silicon, as I already said, the maximum of the valence band occurs at p is equal to 0, but the minimum in the conduction band occurs around 111 direction. This is the 111 direction here. At p is equal to pc. Therefore, in silicon, when an electron makes a transition from maximum point in the valence band to the minimum point in the conduction band, not only an energy change E is equal to Eg is required, but also some momentum change is also required. You need to change the momentum also. However, like in gallium arsenide, you see this is the, you can say, maxima of the valence band and minimum of the conduction band. They are coinciding. They are at the same, you can say, P wave momentum value. So making a transition from this point to this point does not require any change in the momentum. So this kind of, you can say, semiconductors, which are, there is no, you can say, change of momentum is required, or where maximum of the valence band and minimum of the conduction band, they coincides, they are called as the direct semiconductors or direct band gap semiconductor, and the semiconductors where the maxima of valence band and the minimum of the conduction band, they are not coinciding, they are called as the inside you can say indirect semiconductor. So silicon is an indirect semiconductor, because I will repeat once again, because change of momentum is required in a transition. It cannot have without the change of momentum. And you can say gallium arsenide, it is a, you can say, direct band gap semiconductor when a direct transition from valence band to conduction band is possible. So this is so gallium arsenide is, so let us go. So I think we should stop here today, and some part is left in this lecture. We will cover it in the next lecture. Yes, if some short question is there, you can ask, or you can mail me. I have in the first slide I gave you an email address. I can try to reply. Yes, there is one question. Explain by connecting upper and lower figure in earlier slide. Which side it was? There is a question from Ranjana Rathor, who said that please explain connecting upper and lower figures in earlier slide. Which slide?
This.
Okay, so you want to see the code. See, this is a you can say you have a practical. So how to remove this? No other question. No? So now see, this is a you can say problem, or a practical problem, when you have a quantum mechanical particle moving inside a periodic potential, an electron you can say is moving inside a periodic potential. You cannot treat it as a classically. So when you cannot treat it as a classically, what is the way to resolve it? The way is to you can say make a Schrodinger equation, write the potential also, and the solve the equation. So the solution of that equation, the solution of potential that you can say Schrodinger equation, provide you this solution. This is the actually solution. So now during these two points, from like from this, now this x, this value, this y value can have the, I have not written that, but this value is actually, it can have only either plus one or minus one. It cannot have more than plus one or minus value, minus one value. No. It is a sine or cosine function, so it can have without any you can say multiplication. So it can have value between plus one and minus one. So the values which are actually valid are only these values. But my solution, if I plot my solution, simply it gives me these values. So but these values, see, all these values cannot be acceptable. These are not valid values. So these values which for the function, these values are beyond, you can say they are not meeting the suppose you have in left hand side and you have right hand side. So left hand side and right hand side are not meeting during this period. So this we have to completely, you can say, remove. So this, so after, suppose you have reached from this point to pi point, and then from pi to up to this point, there will be no solution. So there will be a gap. Then electron will actually not follow, you can say, the normal this equations, or you can say normal relation of the electron energy to the momentum and like the wave vector relations. So in this case, accordingly, you will get a gap. You will get a discontinuity in the energy, because from this point to this point, these are actually not applicable. So corresponding to these two, if you try to draw it, actually, this is this curve has been shown in the form of Brillouin-Jones. This curve will also come. This curve will also, when you try to put from mix here, they will also come inside. So the distance is like from here to here, it is 0 to pi. So from here to here also, you will see it is pi. So gap is this. So I think it was for the same figure. Could I explain, Ranjanath?
Yes, right side.
This is right side figure, this is left side figure. Acha, these two, you just directly, you cannot see as such, it is not a direct, you can say, one to one direct correlation. This is actually you can say, I have explained the procedure, because there is a gap, because from this point to this point, it is not allowed. So electron cannot have that energies, and so accordingly there is a gap here. So these two are actually independent figures. These three are independent figures, but arriving from one from other. So then we can close. So how to?